Jonathan wrote a musical inspired by La Boheme, where the message is no day but today, and love each other, and don't measure your life in cups of coffee and speeding tickets, but measure it in love. And this shows, you know, the love of Jonathan on stage.
So it's about this group of six friends, basically, a gay couple, two men, a lesbian couple, and a heterosexual couple. Out of that group of six friends, four of them are HIV positive.
Roger, a songwriter, rock and roller. Mark, a filmmaker. Share a loft, can't pay the rent. Try to keep going. We're not
gonna pay. Became very, very much about Jonathan's life and friends. As much as La Boheme is a framework for it, the thing that works about La Boheme is it's really about young artists and what happens in those relationships. So the same was true of all of our lives.
Rent's creator, Jonathan Larson, was a struggling artist in the East Village of New York, just like the characters in his internationally acclaimed rock opera. He worked for years at the Moondance Diner in Soho, and in his spare time worked on writing musicals. Rent was 7 years in the making, and in between he wrote a rock monologue titled Tick Tick Boom about the frustrations of working at the diner and trying to get his musicals produced. Jonathan dropped the first draft of Rent off to Jim Nicola, the New York Theatre Workshop's artistic director. Nicola saw its potential. It went into development, and 2 years later, young producers Jeffrey Seller and Kevin McCollum went to see it.
I turned to Jeffrey after that and I said, that was amazing, and he nodded. And at the end of the first act, I said, you know, let's go, I have to meet him. And so Jeffrey introduced me to him. And I did one of those very cliche producer things where I had my checkbook in my coat jacket, and I opened up my jacket and I said, I'm getting out the checkbook, what do you want? And he laughed, and he said, I just want a full production. And I turned to Jeffrey, and I turned back to Jonathan, and I said, we'll do it. And that's how I met Jonathan Larson.
This is my last day. You've been here forever and ever. So I wanted to say goodbye. I'm a musician. My opera is going to be produced, so I'm going out of food service.
In January 1996, Rent was ready for its first off-Broadway production, but tragedy struck. Just hours after the final dress rehearsal, Jonathan died from an aortic aneurysm, aged just 35. He never knew the international success his Bohemian Rhapsody was to have.
When I read the reviews, opening night off Broadway, the New York Times wrote a Valentine to Jonathan, which he never saw, just too bad. But the show opened February 13th, and on Valentine's Day, the New York Times, which he worshiped, gave the best review they'd probably given in 10 years. And then I knew he was going to live. Yeah. Because if the show closed, he would die. But this way, he would be able to live. So that was a great moment, because I knew he'd had his children in a way.
You can imagine it was a pretty traumatic and devastating event. I think up until that point, people felt, the company felt very passionate about the work, and they were very happy to be a part of it. And I think that loss transformed communally into a bond amongst us all that will never go away.
His death was unbelievably sudden, and as in the death of other people you love, completely devastating.
And that day, I walked around New York with Jeffrey, because, you know, we were both devastated. And we walked into parks and saw people still living, and people, you know, nobody had known Jonathan had passed away. you know, people who didn't had no, and the life kept going. And that's sort of what our resolve was. Well, no matter what happens, we have to make sure his show gets, you know, produced. And, you know, we have Michael, we have Jim, we have the cast, and we have our duty now. It's not just producing a show. It's producing, and sort of like we became a ward of this child called Rent, because Jonathan was no longer there to take care of it.
The morning of the reviews, we sat in this very room, under this skylight, sort of wondering out loud, finally, is this going to move somewhere beyond what we've been thinking? And then it went very quickly from there.
24 hours after opening night at the New York Theatre Workshop, the entire five-week run was sold out. A month-long extension sold out as well, leading to its transfer to Broadway.
The Broadway opening was one of the most amazing. It was like John's father that day had gone and scattered some of John's ashes on the stage, and really no one knew that at the time. And I really feel that Jonathan was there, and the show, like, it was like they were flying off the stage, and everyone in the audience was crying. Huge, huge mega movie stars, glamour, every friend, relative in the world was there. And Jonathan was present. It was like watching someone's spirit, like, ascend. And it was amazing.
You know, Jonathan ought to be here, which is the low. But the high is that the reception it's getting.
Jonathan's music is so unique right now in the theater in that it makes you feel. It has brought feeling back into the theater. And when you can get people to feel, you're home free.
We dedicate this opening night and every performance to our friend Jonathan Larson.
The thing is, Jonathan knew it. Go to parties with him before Rent opened, you know, right after we decided to do this deal with him in 94. And he would tell people, I'm writing the next great musical. I'm writing the next Hair. And people go, and, you know, people would not believe him. It was like, you know, get away from him, you know, because how arrogant for someone to come in a room and tell people he's going to write the next great rock opera. Well, he did it.
Rent won the Pulitzer Prize that year and scooped the Tony Awards, becoming the most honored musical since A Chorus Line in 1976.
Here is the terrifically talented ensemble from Jonathan Larson's Rent.
And the 50th anniversary Tony Award for Best New Musical goes to... Let me do this properly. Rent.
Producers Jerry Seller, Kevin McCullum.
And the 1996 Tony Award for Best Book of a Musical goes to... Jonathan Larson for Rent.
Rent. Music and lyrics, Jonathan Larson.
Once again, accepting for the late Jonathan Larson, his sister Julie.
You know, it took Johnny 15 years of really hard work to become an overnight sensation. So we'd like to share this award with all those who are out there still working in restaurants or driving taxis or doing whatever they have to scrape by for their art. Stay true to yourselves and to your dreams. I know they can come true. This is for you. Thank you.
Broadway's Nederlander Theater is now the permanent home of Rent. 2 years later, tickets are still hard to come by, but a couple of hours before each performance, some of the best seats in the house are sold in a $20 lottery so that people like those portrayed in the show can afford to see it.
All right, guys, listen up. This is how this works. If your name is called, you gotta jump up and down, scream and shout, make some noise for us. You're gonna step forward, line up to my left, single file up against the theater. Only the winners come forward, please. After all the tickets are drawn, don't go anywhere. First name, Margaret Morris.
Yay!
Backstage at the Nederlander, a celebrity shrine of sorts has begun as a tribute to the musical.
We're in the alley, which leads to the stage door at Rent, and on the walls here, we have signatures of celebrities, family and friends, fans of the show. So we have many signatures. Some I'd like to point out. We have John Travolta. He says, to the cast of Rent, thank you for an exciting, touching, amazing, caring show. I'm loving it, and it's only the end of Act One. Then we have Tom Cruise and Nicole Kidman. Here we have Robert De Niro. Here's Liza Minnelli up here. And then down here, Harvey Keitel, and Jonathan Larson's dear friend, Victoria Leacock, signed the wall. up here. Dearest Jonathan, what I would have told you, this version with these beautiful people and your most wonderful new songs is the very best work you've ever done. I am so proud of you. I love you so much. I so want to knock you over with kisses and hugs and to laugh with you and to cry with you. Happy tears because you did it. I will love you to the end of time. Yours always with love.
One of the secrets of Rent's success is that young people struggling in today's society is a tale many can relate to. While it has sad and moving moments, the overall message is a positive one, and ultimately it's a true story.
The Life Cafe in the show is also this cafe, which is called the Bell Cafe. It's right downstairs from Jonathan's apartment, and he spent many mornings, afternoons, and evenings writing Rent here, and he loved it here. 525,600 minutes. I remember when John... I'm cups of coffee in that song, by the way. There's a moment like, how do you measure a year? And he looked at me and he said, how do you measure a year? And I said, cups of coffee. And there's that line in it. I always like that line. A year in the life.
525,600 minutes. How do you measure the life of a woman or a man?
I think there were some things in it that are very close to the actual events of his life, like the apartment that Roger and Mark live in is in a lot of ways based on his apartment. And I think there were certainly parts of him that are both in the characters of Mark and Roger.
This is the phone box where when you went to Jonathan's apartment, you'd have to call him because he lived on the top floor of that gray building. And he would drop his big keychain down and it would land in front of you. And once he almost hit me on the face and I was really worried that I'd be scarred for life. So what we did is I gave him a leather sack and he put the keys in the leather sack. So I figured I'd be unconscious but not scarred. But that's where all the rehearsals for Rent were in the early days, all the backers auditions, well, whatever backers there were. That was where he wrote everything. It was a great apartment. He made it like a little paradise, hovel paradise. That's also, though, where he died. After the final dress rehearsal of the show, he came back. His roommate was at the Ear Inn, the bar down the block. And he went upstairs, put the kettle on for some tea, hung up his coat, and fell face down on the floor of his kitchen. And his roommate, when he got home, he had a couple of flatmates. When he got home, he found him dead. His heart had blown up.
Rent now has a number of productions running in the States. It opened in Canada last year, London earlier this year, and it opens in Australia soon with the world's leading theatre producer, Cameron McIntosh.
And we're all coming to Australia, and we look forward to these trips and to be together and to get to see Jonathan, because every night, eight times a week, Jonathan's alive in a different theatre, telling his story with his voice, and that's meaningful to us.
Rent's Sydney opening in November will follow what was one of the lengthiest and most extensive casting processes of all time. Next, we get an inside look at the auditions and meet the Australian cast who won some of the most sought-after musical theatre roles in years. Rock opera about young artists battling to pay the rent in downtown New York translate to an Australian cast.
Because I don't think it's about the East Village. I think it's about youth and idealism and love and generosity.
My sense is Australia and the sensibility of Australia is much closer to the United States than even Canada. Even though Canada is right next door, there's an adventureness and a willingness to put oneself out there that I get from the Australian spirit.
It's always beautiful to introduce Jonathan's material to a new group of people and see what it brings out in them, because it really has brought out the best in a lot of us.
Performing one song, Glory, from Jonathan Larson's Rent, the fantastic Daphne Ruben Vega.
Not only has Rent's phenomenal success impacted heavily on the lives of its producers and director, but also on its cast members. Daphne Ruben Vega was the first to play the raunchy part of Mimi, a junkie stripper with HIV.
Rent changed my life in terms of, before Rent, I didn't have a career. Before Rent, I lived on popcorn and lemonade. Before Rent, you know, I was a struggling wannabe, you know? I had problems paying the rent.
Daphne left the Rent production last year and has since starred in Wild Things alongside Matt Dillon, Kevin Bacon, and Neve Campbell, and she's currently working on a solo album. It seems Rent is the perfect springboard for young artists needing that big break.
That's the great thing about the show, because we're casting young people. It doesn't matter if they have experience.
Bernie Telsey cast the New York production, walking the streets of the East Village, pressing his card into the hands of those who had the attitude and grunge chic of Rent. He came here in March this year to find the cast for the Australian production. Open calls were held in every major city. Thousands of young and brave hopefuls turned up and queued for hours.
It's a bit daunting, so many people.
The wait really ruins it for you.
This is the first time and I didn't expect that it would be so huge.
Just like a spur of the moment kind of thing. Because I do a course over the other side of the road there.
After the long wait, it's time to give it your best shot.
That was the most daunting experience of my life, put his hand.
Footsteps on the dance floor remind me of you, yeah. Teardrops in my eyes. Next time I'll be true, yeah.
Are you ready?
I know something about love.
And you can tell everybody this is your song. It may be quite simple, but now that it's done.
3 months later, it was time for callbacks.
Hi.
It's actually a lot like the talent we've seen in other countries and other cities.
What's really great is that the director and the musical director are starting to really find people that they like. And that's great, because a lot of them are really coming from the open calls and from the unknown territories. So I think we're going to be in okay shape.
Oh, hello. It's 10 a.m. and my legs are already doing this. Isn't that fantastic? I'm gonna let go and do a layout now. Watch.
I think I did well. I felt good about what I did. Whether I get the part or not, it doesn't matter anymore, because I feel like, you know, I've done what I can, and it's up to them to decide whether I'm right for it or not.
And when I read the character description, I thought, oh, I think I can be really true for this, for the character Angel. So I just think that I'd like to have an opportunity to actually perform it.
By August, the wait was over. After 6 months of auditioning over 6,000 young hopefuls, the new Australian cast were introduced to the media in Sydney by Rent fan Molly Meldrum.
You know a guy called Opal, because there's this wonderful part in Rent of a character called Angel, who is this drag queen.
Today for you, tomorrow for me. Today for you, tomorrow for me.
And he is just, no, he is superb, Angel, in New York. And I thought, they'll never find an Angel in this country. Now, in my, you know, days of going out in Melbourne and going to some of these strange places like Three Faces, etc., etc., I happened to see this guy from across the... I said, who's he? Who's he? Christ. I said, you know, I said, he's that Angel that's in that play in New York. Believe it or not, Opal has got the part of Angel in this play. Here's the cast.
Australian casting director Christopher Green was happy to see the audition process complete, even though there were some humorous moments.
We had people that took their clothes off. We obviously had people that were high when they came in to see us. And of course, there were many people, because we were trying to attract people that weren't professionals and necessarily from theatre. that came in and absolutely froze and couldn't do anything. I've seen productions all around the world, and that is why I'm so excited. And in fact, it's not just me that thinks that. The creative team that came out here from New York and indeed from around the world are incredibly excited about this group of people.
This is over.
It feels fantastic. I mean, just with things like tonight, it's now finally becoming real. Beforehand, it was just a whole process of in, out, phone call, back, all that sort of stuff, you know. But now it's like, meet the cast. Everything's more real now, so it's great.
Well, yeah. I've made it. It feels fantastic.
My agent called me up and said, actually, it was a bit of bad news because, well, not so much bad news, but she said, it's not the part, not what, probably what you want. They've offered you the understudy, and I went for the part of Angel, and they've offered me the ensemble plus first cover for Angel. So basically it means I came second. All right. But that's fine. That's fine.
So, will Opal have to watch his back?
No, I'm not that kind of guy. Where is he? Where is he? No. If he was an asshole, well, yeah, maybe he would. But he's too nice a guy. I'll let him do it.
Justin Smith was chosen for the key narrator's part of Mark, the struggling filmmaker, even though he doesn't yet look the part.
The riot continues. The Christmas tree goes up in flames.
Oh, not my hair!
I don't know about the glasses. I'll fight that one right to the end.
The part of Roger, Mark's wannabe rock star flatmate, was given to Roger Corser, who was plucked from his Melbourne covers band Hype.
Totally new process for me. I've never been to an audition before, so, I mean, having to sing in front of, say, five people on a panel is way more intimidating than having to sing in front of 400 rowdy, drunk patrons, you know what I'm saying?
The role of Maureen, Mark's ex-girlfriend, who's switched sides and now goes out with Joanne, will be played by Michelle Smith.
Tonight is like the second night that we've all met, and it feels like we're a family already.
525,000 bottles of beer.
Most of the cast are little-known struggling artists in keeping with the vibe of Rent. However, internationally successful solo artist Annie Crummer's in the ensemble, and Christine Arnoux will play Mimi.
It's great that they're known, but they weren't cast on their profile at all. In fact, I was very careful for my colleagues on the creative team not to know that they actually had a profile, that they in fact were like anybody else that came into the rehearsal room when they auditioned, and because they were hungry for the roles and because they were the best people on the day, they actually got the roles.
It felt strange being in a queue full of people that, some that didn't know you, some that knew of you, some that knew you, and to be, you know, three or five people away from everybody and going, what are you doing here? And I don't know, I think that's all about the excitement of going for a part, that you're as equal as everybody else out there on that street and that you don't get the part because you're Christine Arnoux. I've come from dance theatre, which is not exactly musical theatre, but it doesn't incorporate the acting as much. But I'm not new to theatre, and this again is like being a kid in a candy store, acting, singing, dancing, and you know, I was discovered singing as a dancer, so I'm back home as far as I'm concerned. 3 hours of being on it now, I think. Make sure that this is enough.
Two principal parts are being filled by Americans who auditioned in the States. Fred Jones and Mark Ford were perfect for the roles of Benny, the dodgy landlord, and Tom Collins, Angel's boyfriend. And this production provided them with an opening.
London has a bunch of Americans. Now our American company has a Brit. You know, I mean, because, we had an extra Roger in Britain and we needed one in America and we don't have one. So let's take that guy that we saw. So, you know, long as you work out all the equity thing, I think, you know, in the long term, Rent will be maybe a pioneer in breaking down that wall of like, oh, Aussie versus American versus Britain. Like, who cares?
The first time they met the Australian cast was at rehearsals, which started in September.
Oh, they're totally mad, just mad.
Oh, yeah, they're crazy. I mean, and it's like, each person has been perfectly cast for the role that they're playing.
I think it's really exciting being here because it's a brand new company. And what's really exciting about this cast is that I've seen this show 3 times myself in New York. And so I had preconceived notions about how the show should go, whereas most of the people here haven't seen it. And so it's totally new, and the people in Australia aren't really familiar with the show. So I think it's going to be really exciting to watch the reaction that, you know, the people have. And as far as watching the cast come together and perform, it's really great because it's so new to them, you know. And so they're each creating their own roles and they're each creating their own character, and that's really exciting.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Shut up.
Resident director Warren Coleman can't believe his luck in working with such a vibrant bunch of people.
It's like a chemical reaction. You put everything in the tube and it starts fizzing, and that's what's been happening. And the job becomes more, for me, focusing that energy. But that's so much more fun a job than trying to find it and lift it and hurt. And that's certainly never been a problem with the troupe of people, as you can tell. It's gotta happen. I'm sorry, but these guys are nuts.
Good morning.
How am I here, mate? Just okay?
Yeah, I'm good. I've got a lolly in my mouth.
Get it out.
The first couple of days was everyone was a little bit, I suppose, nervous and holding back a bit, and then it just sort of took one person, I think, to sort of break the ice. You know, the first person that belts out a big song, and you know, everyone,
it didn't it?
Yeah, everyone sort of claps and cheers, and everyone goes, well,
that's not so bad, is it?
Yeah, and I'll go with them and stuff like that.
Christine?
Yeah, no, I think for me it's a lot different performing to a group of 10 people than it is to a crowd of 40,000 or less.
Much 20,000. Harder, I reckon.
It is.
I suppose doing it in front of a supportive group like this is one thing, then taking it out in front of people who expect to be entertained, and they will be, but it's going to be nervous.
Rent opens on November the 4th at Sydney's Theatre Royal in what's being billed as one of the most eagerly anticipated theatre events in decades.
It's a people show, it's a life show, it's a living show. Like, I think no day but today is the perfect summary for Rent.
Say, oh, it's too dramatic, there's too many people in the show that have AIDS. The same was our group of friends. That was our circle. We weren't not nice people. We weren't surrounded by, you know, whatever nice means. We weren't in a drug culture.
As successful as it has become, there's always the humility of that Jonathan isn't here, and the lesson that it is all fragile, and we must do what we can while we're here, which is the same message that Rent has.
I just want to say good day, Australia, and have a wonderful time doing Rent there. Good day.
David Lynch and The Doors, next on Arena Presents. The funk.